يا يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا
إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي
محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Welcome to another episode of Quran in Depth, and we are in Surah At-Tawbah. And tawbah means repentance, and repentance means to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when a person is returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if he had went far, and according to the sin, whether it's disbelief or major sins or minor sins, a person takes himself away from the creator of the heavens and the earth with the sins and the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the real joy of this life. This is the real success of this life and in the hereafter. And in Surah At-Tawbah, the word At-Tawbah is repeated many times, which shows that this is the job, the lifetime job of the human being, that we should constantly repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All human beings are all the same, meaning they are from the same father and mother, the same lineage. They all come from the same origin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them all for a great purpose. They're not created for play. They're created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And that's why when we look into humanity from that perspective, that they all, yes, created in tribes and nations and different colors and different looks and so on, but they are humans. And they all share one thing, and that is the fitrah, or the innate, the nature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth. When a messenger is sent to them, asking them, calling them, ordering them to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship none but the creator of the heavens and the earth alone, to be obedient to him, to follow the messengers of Allah, this is what makes a person among the believers, and therefore the human beings, they become believers or disbelievers. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us, to be obedient to him, to follow his orders. And the final messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him with the perfect way of life, with guidance, that there's no messenger to come after him, calling people to the truth, calling people to willingly submit themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll go through verses inshallah ta'ala from Surah At-Tawbah, and it shows the importance of being upon the truth and the superiority of the truth. And the entire life of humanity, there is this struggle between the truth and the falsehood, and putting aside all kinds of differences, but we need to look into the truth as the ultimate and the absolute truth versus falsehood. So we'll go through verses inshallah ta'ala from number 28 all the way to 33, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permit, and we'll get to understand and to benefit from these verses and why were they revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Especially these verses, many people, they have misunderstanding to it, and they take things out of context. So let's start with verse number 28. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ نَجَسٌ فَلَا يَقْرَبُوا الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامَ بَعْدَ عَامِهِمْ هَذَا وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ عَيْلَةً فَسَوْفَ يُغْنِيكُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ إِنْ شَاءَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. Which means, O you have believed, indeed the polytheists are unclean, so let them not approach al-Masjid al-Haram after this, their final year. And if you fear privation, Allah will enrich you from His bounty if He wills. Indeed, Allah is knowing and wise. This verse revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam after, as we heard before, he sent Abu Bakr radiallahu an, and with him Ali radiallahu anhu, to the people making Hajj, to declare that this, after this year that they were sent, which is the ninth year of the Hijjah, that there's no mushrik, no polytheist, no someone that would worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be there to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, declaring that the Masjid al-Haram, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is only for those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, for the Muslimin, for those who submit themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ordered them and gave them the 4 months for them to leave, so that this is the place where only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be worshipped. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the believers and showing the reason and the wisdom behind it. And as all of these calls in the Quran that starts with Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, to give it our understanding, to listen to it carefully, because after it, it's either an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the believers to do, or something that they are forbidden from doing. And it depends who are the ones that are being addressed by these orders. Sometimes it's the people of authority, those who are in charge, and sometimes it's every single individual Muslim. Sometimes it's to the men, sometimes it's to specifically to the women, and so on and so forth. So as important as knowing these orders and having the knowledge of it, we need to know who are these orders are addressed to, in what context, and for who, at what time, in what situation and circumstances, and so on and so forth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the believers, stating the fact that the mushrikun, the polytheists, those who associate partners with Allah, those who went against their own pure innate, those who they associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that created them, the creator, the sustainer, the owner of all things, and they believe in him, that he's the creator of the heavens and the earth. But when they worship, they worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. They make dua to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They make sujood, they prostrate to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on. As the people of Quraysh at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they had these idols, these images, these statues that they would worship it besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would sacrifice for it, they would make dua to it, and they would ask from it. And they did all of this as a way to for these idols and these images to intercede for them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the believers that indeed the mushrikun are najas, they're unclean. And najasa is impurity. And this impurity is not the physical outside appearance impurity, but rather this is the inward impurity. And that's something that, you know, when a person understands this, we see that in the hearts, the place where the belief is, when it comes to matters of creed and intentions and deeds done by the heart, it's not clean. And therefore, as important as it is for a person to be physically clean, and as we know that in our religion, we are ordered to be always physically clean. We have to make wudu, we have to be in state of purification every time we pray at least the 5 daily salah. And every time a person wants to make salah, he has to be physically pure. And there are rulings to this, and you know, and we're even ordered to clean ourselves and clean our homes and so on. So as important, even more importantly, to clean oneself from within. And therefore, ash-shirk, or associating partners with Allah, causes this impurity to the heart. These hearts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Polluting the hearts is when the hearts are attached to other than Allah. When the hearts worship other than the creator of the heavens and the earth, that pollutes the hearts. The same thing when the hearts have any form of transgression and evil deeds or evil intentions, whether it's envy or arrogance or hatred to others or whatever these sinful deeds done by the heart, these are all things that makes the heart impure. It pollutes the heart, and of course there are different levels of impurities there. So when it comes to the mushrikeen, those who associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the next verses also will mention this, and more of their characteristics, they are impure, they are unclean. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, ordering the believers, فَلَا يَقَرَبُوا الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامَ بَعْدَ عَامِهِمْ هَذَا. Then, so let them not approach al-masjid al-haram as a result of that. So do not let them approach, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the wisdom behind it. Again, it's not the physical impurity, but what's in their hearts. Al-masjid al-haram in Mecca is a place where only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be worshipped. The tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is declared by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sending Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Ali radiallahu anhu to declare this matter very clearly to the people, that no mushrik, no one that associate partners with Allah will make Hajj from now on there. Why? Because they declare, the meaning the mushrikeen, the polytheists, those who associate partners with Allah, they go to the Masjid al-Haram, which is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, invoking other than Allah, invoking their idols, their images that they made with their own hands and so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear that this is not permissible for them after the Muslimin, after the Prophet ﷺ become in charge of Al-Masjid al-Haram, not to allow such an evil and impure act to be established there anymore. فَلَا يَقَرَبُوا الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامَ بَعْدَ عَامِهِمْ هَذَا. After this year, which was the ninth year of the Hijjah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressing the believers, if the believers, they might be concerned about their trade, and this is a time where every year at the time of Hajj, the pilgrims, they come from everywhere. And this is, yes, days of ibadah and worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but also times where people, they accumulate wealth and they do trade, and it's such a great, you know, money-wise and provisions for them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when ordering the believers to not to allow the mushrikeen, the polytheists, to enter the Masjid al-Haram, to be there in Mecca, and when it comes to matters of Hajj and other than Hajj, He said to them, وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ عَيْلَةً فَسَوْفَ يُغْنِيكُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. That if you fear private, if you fear that you become poor, if you feel privation, if you fear any of this, that you would have deficiency in your provisions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enrich you. فَسَوْفَ يُغْنِيكُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you rich from His bounty subhanahu wa ta'ala, insha, if He wills, because the rizq and the provisions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most rich, and He's the one that is giving you the orders. So therefore, rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He would never let you down if you are obedient to Him. And this is a concept and a principle that never fails. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers to do something or forbade them of something, definitely this is what is best for them. And who is the one that provides? And that's the test of one's iman and faith. The provider is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one that orders is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how can someone contradict himself? If someone would disobey the orders of Allah out of the fear of poverty, for example, that negates the fact that he believes that the provider is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's the provider, and he's the one that is given this order. So there's no contradiction. So don't worry. You take the means, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for you, and everything is by the will of Allah. And you might disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of the fear of poverty, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you even more poor. Or, which is even worse, that if someone disobeys the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him even more rich, and more abundance in wealth, and offsprings, and strength, and so on. People might think that this is an evidence that they're doing good. No, that's not. It's the total opposite. That's an evidence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry with them. And this entire world and whatever it contains does not value anything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not care about you unless you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, unless you invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَلَا أُولَادُكُمْ بِالَّتِي تُقَرِّبُكُمْ عِنْدَنَا زُلْفَ إِلَّا مَنْ آمَنَ. That your wealth, your offspring, is not the thing that gets you and draw you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except those who believe and do righteous good deeds and so on. So therefore, it's a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person, every time he disobeys the orders of Allah, he is given more and more of the wealth and the health and the strength on the face of earth, opposite to what many human beings, they think. And if you want to see how truth that is, read the Quran. You would find the Quran very clear about this, mentioned in Surah Al-An'am, as we talked about it before, and many other places. So to be among the successful ones, that is to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for the believers, if they are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for them. Inna Allaha alimun hakeem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-knower, and He is the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the all-knowing subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows. Whenever He gives an order, He knows exactly the outcome of it. And He knows the affairs of the believers and the disbelievers, and He knows what's in the hearts of both. So the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is from the one that has the ultimate knowledge, and He's the most wise. And that's by the wisdom of Allah. It's not foolishly done, it's by the wisdom of Allah. So rely on Allah. Have good thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and never to think anything but perfect when it comes to the orders of Allah that brings all kinds of goodness and success in this life and in the hereafter. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala with more of these verses after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah, Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back, and we are with verses number 28 to 33 in Surah At-Tawbah. And the verses in these set of verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the believers at the time of the Prophet ﷺ and all the way to the Day of Judgment, when the believers, they have the means, and showing the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala behind these orders and protecting the most sacred places on the face of earth, like the city of Mecca and the Masjid al-Haram, from the disbelievers, those who associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how that they are impure inside of them, not necessarily physically, but inside of them in their hearts, with their disbelief, with them associating partners with Allah, with disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with arrogance, with transgressing the limits of Allah, and so on. Then the next verse, verse number 29, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam, قَاتِلُوا الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَلَا بِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَلَا يُحَرِّمُونَ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَلَا يَدِينُونَ دِينَ الْحَقِّ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ حَتَّى يُعْطُوا الْجِزْيَةَ عَنْ يَدٍ وَهُمْ صَاغِرُونَ. Which means, fight those who do not believe in Allah or in the last day, and who do not consider unlawful what Allah and His Messenger have made unlawful, and who do not adopt the religion of truth from those who were given the scripture. Fight until they give the jizya willingly while they are humbled. This ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam to fight, and this came down to the Prophet ﷺ before the war that the Prophet ﷺ went against the Romans, when they were preparing themselves to fight the Prophet ﷺ. The enmity to the Prophet ﷺ and to the believers was not just limited to the people of Quraysh or to the Arab. The Romans, the Persians, you know, they were getting the news about the Prophet ﷺ and the companions radiallahu anhum, and they wanted to, according to their thinking, that they would want to wipe away this religion and this way of life, and to eliminate them completely from the face of earth, anything that would threaten the superiority of these evil ones. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet ﷺ to go out to them and to fight them this inevitable war to protect the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that would support them and give them victory and guide them and help them. So this is how the verse were revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, and it mentions the wisdom behind it. And when it comes to fighting, this is a subject that many people, they have a lot of misunderstanding. And when we talk about religion, we're not just talking about things that has no reality to the lives of the people. When we look at the face of earth, was it ever at any time in history of mankind and today, there was such a thing as there's no fighting whatsoever, that people are living on the face of earth without any form of aggression or force or any of transgression and injustices and so on? It does not exist. This is not how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this life on the face of earth. Those who are superior, either they are the people of the truth or the people of falsehood. The people of the truth, if they are superior, that means if the truth is superior, and these people, they apply the truth, not just in title, not just in name, but in reality. They follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ. They would spread all kinds of goodness and justice, and humanity would be, the happiest ever. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only orders people to apply and to perform justice and goodness and mercy and so on. But if they don't, then when the people of falsehood are superior, that means falsehood will be superior, and therefore they would spread all kinds of evil on the face of earth. They would spread bloodshed in an unjust way. They would spread all kinds of injustices and killing and corruption and all kinds of evil sins that is widespread all over the earth. And we see the reality of the life that we live in today. with all kinds of evil actions. And if we just count the sinful acts that every decent human being, let alone being a believer, every decent human being would abhor so much and would consider it so evil. There are so many. And it's done by those who are superior on the land. Why? Because of the falsehood that people they adopt. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He ordered the Prophet والسلام, and this ummah of the Prophet, والسلام, the ummah of the truth, for this ummah to carry the truth and to be upon the truth, if they are superior, they won't treat others with injustice. They won't shed blood of others. And that's why there's difference between qatilu and qtulu. Right? There's killing and there's fighting. There's major difference between both. So when this verse and the like of it is taken out of context, then people would interpret it as kill all those who disbelieve. There's no such a thing. This is about fighting in an organized war that has its rulings and its perfect way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be upon. Otherwise, if it's not done this way, then it will become corruption on the face of earth. And this is what humanity would see if the truth is not superior. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering the believers to do that against those who do not believe in Allah or the last day. So this is the wisdom. That means they have all kinds of impurities. When a person does not believe in Allah and the last day, what that means, what that entitles, what's the implications of this? And they are superior on the land. What happens? They would shed blood and they don't care. There's no fear of Allah. There's no fear that there will be a day of judgment where they will be brought back to the justice of Allah. So they do whatever they want according to their interest. Their ends will justify the means that they will take. They want something, they will take all the means, especially if they have the means. If they are superior, if they have the strength and the power, they will do whatever it takes. Why? Because there's no fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't believe in Allah. They don't believe in the last day. So you can imagine how much evil and corruption will be on the face of earth, and that's what again we see on the face of earth. وَلَا يُحَرِّمُونَ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And they do not forbid what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbid, meaning making unlawful and lawful. And therefore, if they do not consider what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made unlawful, what do they do? What's unlawful in the deen of Islam? It's unlawful to shed the blood of those who are innocent. So they don't consider that as something unlawful. So they would do that. They would spread all kinds of bloodshed on the face of earth. We know that in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and according to the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade shedding blood without the right to do so. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade stealing, forbade treating others with humility, with arrogance, and to give the rights of people. And we heard that even in the same surah from the beginning of it. And all of these rulings has mercy in it. And the ultimate truth is for people to get to see the truth. That's one of the basic rights of the human beings, to get to see the truth without being distorted, without them being deceived. So that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers to do so if they have the means, and they do not consider unlawful what Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam consider unlawful. وَلَا يَدِينُونَ دِينَ الْحَقِّ. And they're not upon the deen of al-haq. They're not upon the truth. They do not adopt the religion of the truth. And if they don't, that means what? They adopt the religion of falsehood. And falsehood brings all kinds of misery and injustices and evil actions and so on. مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ. From among the people of the scripture. حَتَّى يُعْتُوا الْجِزْيَةِ. They have books, the Torah, the Injil. They had messengers sent to them before the Prophet ﷺ, Musa ﷺ, Isa ﷺ, and many messengers of Allah. And they were upon the Tawheed. They were upon the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the followers of these messengers, they used to consider unlawful what these messengers were sent by to order them to consider what is unlawful. But then after the messengers of Allah, after they returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they changed things. They altered things. They changed the rulings. They associated partners with Allah. They worshipped other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They made unlawful what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made lawful, and vice versa. They made it permissible for the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it unlawful for them. And that's why the things that we see in the religion of Islam as being unlawful, it wasn't just something that is originated at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is something that has been also from the previous messengers of Allah. But the previous nations, they deviated from the truth. It's even many of them, they have it in their books today, but they changed their religion for whatever reasons, but they changed their religion following their desires, turning away from the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they do not adopt the religion of the truth, these people of the book. So as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you fight them and so on, حَتَّى يُعْتُوا الْجِزْيَةَ عَنْ يَدِي وَهُمْ صَغِرُونَ, till they give the jizya. And the jizya is money to be taken from each and every one of them among the male, not every single person. عَنْ يَدٍ, that means they have to give it in hands while they are humbled. That means they don't have the upper hand. They don't have superiority. There is a level of humility that has to be there because they are upon falsehood. And in return, they get protected. They get treated with justice. They get to be left alone with their acts of worship, with even what they make unlawful even. You know, if it's according to them, they can even rule among themselves with their own rulings without even having to come to the Muslim judge and so on. And many rulings that comes as a result of that. But for the truth to be superior. And when the people of the truth, they have the means, they have to establish the truth. And this is something that no human being with decency would deny, that this is such a beautiful thing. And of course it is. Plus, after all, the struggle between the truth and falsehood will continue to the Day of Judgment. And if the people of the truth, they compromise the truth, what happens? Falsehood becomes superior. And falsehood spread. And falsehood means evil and bloodshed. And attacking the honor and dignity of people. And all kinds of miseries that humanity, they live and they experience as a result of turning away from the truth, from the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the deviant beliefs of the people of the book. When they are called to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invited them to follow the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to follow the final messenger of Allah. And they refused, and exposing their evil beliefs. And as we will see inshallah ta'ala in the coming verses, and how they associated partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we see the next verse, which is verse number 30, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ عُزَيْرٌ ابْنُ اللَّهِ وقالت النصارى المسيح ابن الله ذلك قولهم بأفواههم يضاهئون قول الذين كفروا من قبل قاتلهم الله أنى يؤفكون. Which means the Jews say Uzair, Isra is the son of Allah, and the Christians say the Messiah, meaning Isa عليه السلام, Jesus is the son of Allah. That is their statement from their mouths. They imitate the saying of those who disbelieved before them. May Allah destroy them. How are they deluded? As the ayah says, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودِ, the Jews, they said, Uzair or Isra is the son of Allah. This is not necessarily all of them, but a sect of them or some of them, even if it's in the past and it does not exist anymore. But some of them said, and the rest they approved. And this is something that is so evil, to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most superior. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in no need of anyone. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. One third of the Quran is this surah, Suratul Ikhlas, is equal to one third of the Quran, as the Prophet ﷺ said, because it talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no son. Nobody had begotten him, and he has no son whatsoever. He is in no need whatsoever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of him. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. He's the most superior. He's the one that have the might and the power and the provision. He's the owner of all things, the one that has the sovereignty of the heavens and the earth. He's the most compassionate, the most merciful, the most wise, and so on and so on and so forth with the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when a person have the love of Allah, know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his names and attributes, and then get to see these evil acts of belief, to claim to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has a son, how degrading and how evil that is, to get something that has no evidence to it whatsoever, something that is false, completely made up, has nothing to do with the messengers of Allah. No messenger of Allah ever would ever call the people or invite the people or believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son, and he would call the people to this. as the verse said, but we'll continue that inshallah ta'ala and more after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back, and still with verse number 30 from Surah At-Tawbah about those who claim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son, as the verse as we heard, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ عُزَيْرٌ ابْنُ اللَّهِ, that the Jews, they said Uzair or Isra is the son of Allah. As we said, not all of them, a group of them, or even as it's claimed, this was in the past and they do not exist today, but still it's something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about a group of them, that they said that and claimed this. وقالت النصارى المسيح ابن الله, and the Christians, they claim that المسيح, Messiah, ابن الله, the son of Allah, عيسى, Jesus, the son of Mary, as they claimed is the son of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most exalted. And when we look into the verses of the Quran, more than one place, how this is addressed by the Quran, that this is something that is so evil and so unjust, and such an evil belief for a person to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and earth, the one that nothing is the like of him, he has a son. And what that implies? Implies that he is deficient, وَلَعَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, that he is in need. And this is no evidence of that whatsoever. No messenger of Allah would ever say such a thing, and nobody would ever believe in such a thing. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated their statements, he said, ذَلِكَ قَوْلُهُمْ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ, this is their speech, this is their statement with their own mouths. It does not go beyond that, has no reality to it. And when we look at this part of the verse, it's amazing, because as human beings, we are given this al-bayan, or to be able to express ourselves and to speak. And such a powerful thing, this ability to speak, and how it deviates many people and also guides people. And therefore, human beings, they say all kinds of things. And their speech, whether it's physical speech or writings or whatever means of communications that they have, you know, people say things. And many of the things that are being said has no reality to it. You know, human beings are given the choice whether to lie or to say the truth. And therefore, there's so many lies out there. But the sad reality of it, that many people, they would believe the lies, and they would follow the lies. And that's why this is something that is very dangerous, when people just, they say things and people listen to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned the believers, and even mentioned, as we heard before in Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَفِيكُمْ سَمَّعُونَ لَهُمْ, that some of you, they give their ears to them, they listen to them. And that's why we have to stay away from listening and hearing falsehood. You know, because people, they say all kinds of things. And many times you would even hear more than one time in the same day, a person would say, I believe this, I believe that. Where did you get your belief from? Is it something that a person saw in their dreams? Or something that a person just think that this is the truth? Talking about matters of unseen, things that the people didn't see, they have no ability and no power whatsoever to get to know the unseen. And they would talk about it as if they are seeing it with their own eyes. Who have the right to do that? And that's why the only way for a person to talk about the unseen, it has to be through revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if it's revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it has to be protected. It has to be guarded for the people to see the truth. So, ذَلِكَ قَوْلُهُمْ بِأَفْوَهِمْ, this is nothing but speech with their own mouths. It does not go beyond that. ذَلِكَ قَوْلُهُمْ بِأَفْوَهِمْ. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most superior. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of him. ذَلِكَ قَوْلُهُمْ بِأَفْوَهِمْ. But where did they come up with such a made-up belief? يُضَاهِئُونَ قَوْلَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ قَبْلِ. يُضَاهِئُونَ, they imitate the speech of the disbelievers before them. So this is an imitation. They got this false belief from some of the acts of disbelief from the nations before, whether it's the, you know, the ancient Egyptians or the ancient this or that, something that they got their, you know, their beliefs from them. They imitated them. And of course, Shaitan, he has his ways, and he whispers to the people, and things become different, and they change, and they implement it by force and by superiority, and then generations are raised without knowing the truth, and they just follow blindly their parents and their forefathers without thinking, without getting to ask about the truth. So this is what the reality of many of the human beings. So يُضَاهِئُونَ قَوْلَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ قَوْلِ. They imitate the speech of those who disbelieved before them. قَاتَلَهُمُ اللَّهِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroy them. They brought the worst ever statements whatsoever. That's the worst thing that can ever happen on the face of earth, and that is to associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also would order the believers to be just to them and to be kind to them and so on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He made the matter very clear. In the hereafter, those who are in that state of disbelief and they continue after the message reaches them and they die and they return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this level of disbelief, their place in the hereafter is in the hellfire forever. So out of the compassionate towards them, that they should repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And don't forget that the title of the surah is Surah At-Tawbah, for them to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for them to see the truth and to leave away these evil beliefs. أَنَّ يُؤْفَكُونَ. How they are deluded. They are deluded by their people in charge of them, their religious leaders, those who know the truth. They are deluded by these false statements that has no reality to it whatsoever. That's why those who are wise among them, those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows His favor upon, they would, once they see the truth, they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it happened to those who came to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And it keeps on happening when people get to see the truth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent. Also, one of the things that made them deluded and made them follow blindly falsehood, the next verse, verse number 31. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله والمسيح ابن مريم وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا إلها واحدا لا إله إلا هو سبحانه عما يشركون. Which means, they have taken their scholars and monks as lords besides Allah, and also the Masih, the son of Mary, and they were not commanded except to worship one God. There is no deity except Him. Exalted is He above whatever they associate with Him. So this is also some of the reasons why they adopted these evil beliefs and why they were deluded, because they took اتخذوا, they took أحبارهم. أحبارهم meaning their scholars, the people of knowledge among them, ورهبانهم, and those who worship, the worshippers among them, the monks, those who secluded themselves in worship. They took these two categories of people, أَرْبَابًا مِّن دُونِ اللَّهِ. أَرْبَابًا, lords besides Allah. One of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, which is Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu anhu, he used to be a Christian and he became a Muslim. And when this verse was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, he asked the Prophet ﷺ, he said, O Prophet of Allah, we didn't take them as lords besides Allah. He understood from it, lords meaning that they believe their scholars and their monks are lords besides Allah, they create, they sustain and so on. The Prophet ﷺ explained to him why this is mentioned. He said, weren't they the ones that would make lawful for you lawful, and what's unlawful they make it unlawful? They're the ones that decide for you what is halal and what is haram. They're the ones that implement among you what is permissible and what's not permissible. He said, yes. He said, this is how you took them as arbaban. This is how you took them as lords besides Allah. Because who is the one, the only one that has the right to declare what is halal and what is haram? To make it clear that this is permissible and this is not permissible. Who is the one that has the right to forbid something on the face of earth? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. This is one of the attributes of the Lord, of the rububiyyah, the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is the one that makes what's halal, halal, what's permissible, permissible, and what's unlawful, unlawful. So since these human beings, they made it themselves, they made the religion themselves. Nothing from Isa, the son of Mary, nothing from the messengers of Allah, nothing from revelation from Allah, it's something from their own selves. And that's why they keep on changing and changing and changing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying why they were deviated when they took their scholars and their monks as lords besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we look into the other hand, for the believers, for the Muslims, who's the one that has the right to make what halal halal and what's haram haram? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How the religion of Islam is completed, is perfected. It is not for a human being to declare that this is halal and this is haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned the believers, as it's mentioned in Surah An-Nahl and others, but one of which, وَلَا تَقُولَ لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبُ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبُ. One of the worst crimes on the face of earth is to make up a lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, do not say this with your own tongues, that this is halal and this is haram. Unlawfully, that means in a way that is false, not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for you to forge a lie against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those who do this, they have a severe punishment waiting for them. So that's why when we say shedding blood is haram, this is not something that we made up. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to forbid. When we forbid stealing, when we forbid zina, adultery, when we forbid all kinds of evil, riba, usury, interest, lying, and so on and so forth, this is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not something that a person would make up. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that about them, that they took their scholars and their monks as arbab and as lords besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-Masih ibn Maryam, and also al-Masih ibn Maryam, Jesus the son of Mary, they took him as lord beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And al-Masih ibn Maryam, Jesus the son of Mary, one of Ulil Azmi and Rusul, one of the best messengers of Allah, he declared it himself clearly, as it's mentioned in Surah Al-Ma'idah before, that he is nothing but a slave of Allah and a messenger of Allah. And he did not order the people to do anything except to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. He did not order the people to worship him besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask Isa alayhi salam, as it's mentioned in the Quran, in the Day of Judgment. أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ اتَّخِذُونِي وَأُمِّيَ إِلَهَيْنِ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Did you tell the people to take me, meaning Jesus the son of Mary, and his mother as lords besides Allah, as to be worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The verse is at the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah, and we talked about that before. He said definitely not. And he glorified Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this is not for him to say something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not order him to say. He's a messenger of Allah. And someone that worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, someone that made sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and humbled himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship, how can he call the people to worship him instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when there's no messenger whatsoever ever sent to the people to call the people to worship a messenger of Allah? But rather, he would call them to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So this is what they did to Isa the son of Mary. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا. They were not ordered except to worship one ilah, one God, one to be worshipped. And that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا إله إلا هو. There is no one worthy of worship except Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سُبْحَانَهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. That means glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, away from exalted, from what they associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. So we know that for sure, with certainty. They were never ordered to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They can never bring an evidence to that whatsoever. Things that can be distorted, they would misunderstand it. Something that is very clear. This is, you know, articles of faith that should not have any doubts in it whatsoever. And we learned that in the Deen of Al-Islam. You know, would any Muslim have any doubt that in the Deen of Al-Islam we are ordered to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone? The entire Quran from the beginning to the end is about the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the evidence of that. One evidence after the other, universal evidences and evidences from the Wahi revelation from Allah, intellectual evidences, messengers before, you know, no doubt whatsoever. Even the rulings are very clear. And when it comes to the most important article of faith and how to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in their books it won't be that clear that they have to search for a verse here or there that might mean more than one thing, and it's not really explicit to state these types of meanings. So the Quran makes it very clear, and the Quran takes over all of the different revelations before. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and earth, he says, وَمَا أُمِرُوا, they were never ordered. إِلَّا except لِيَعْبُدُوا إِلَهًا وَحِدًا. That means, as you see in the verse and the context of it like this, that the only thing that they were ordered is to worship إِلَهًا وَحِدًا. Only one God, the creator of the heavens and earth, the Lord of Isa, Jesus, the son of Mary, the Lord of Musa alayhi salam, the Lord of Ibrahim, the Lord of the final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam, the Lord of all beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is nothing is the like of him. He's above his creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the most high, he is the most knowledgeable, he is the most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is the like of him, and he's the all-hearer, the all-seer, subhanahu wa ta'ala. La ilaha illahu, this is the tawheed. No one worthy of worship except him. Any act of worship is to be done to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, not to associate partners with Allah, not to turn to other than Allah. This is the fitrah, this is the nature of the human beings, that nobody with goodness and decency inside would ever deny this. And we would see how it is impure for someone to believe otherwise, to believe that Allah has a son, for people to associate partners with Allah, to deny the truth. That's why subhanahu amma yushrikun, glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the most exalted, away from what they associate with Him in partners. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also makes it clear what is the purpose of these people, what are their concern, why should be whatever is mentioned in the verses of fighting and all of this, what's the wisdom behind it? Also, it will be explained in the next couple of verses and more. You know, but because of the time, we'll stop here inshallah ta'ala, and we'll continue next time as part two with this context of verses, so that we can learn more of the truth and how the truth is superior at all times, by the way. Even if it's not physically superior by the people of the truth as we speak it, as we say it like this, nobody can oppose it whatsoever with intellectual evidences and reasons, because it takes over. The truth is the most superior thing. That's why people, they need to witness this. And when people get to understand the haqq, the truth, they find it superior. And the falsehood is always inferior. But sometimes the falsehood, people might, you know, add to it all kinds of physical superiority that doesn't make any benefit whatsoever to them, only temporary. We'll continue with that inshallah ta'ala, but next time, in the next episode, then we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who learn the book of Allah, and to be among the people of the Quran, and to be upon the truth, and to protect us from all harm till we are returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
إلا الذين تابوا وأصلحوا وبينوا فأولئك أتوب عليهم وأنا التواب الرحيم.
فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون.
يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام.
يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهداً